probably seen that prayer before. You've probably recited that prayer before. You've probably prayed that prayer before. It's known as the Lord's Prayer. And today we're studying Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 13. And I want to talk to you about this subject, praying like Jesus. Praying like Jesus. I'm finishing our series on great prayers of the Bible, and no series on prayer would be complete without including the prayer of Jesus in Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. We often call it the Lord's Prayer, but it might be better termed the disciples' prayer. Jesus is teaching us how to pray. This is a model prayer. He's not saying this is the way you ought to always pray. Recite these words exactly like they're written. What he's saying is this is a model for us to learn. This is a pattern for us to follow when we pray. Today from Matthew 6, I'm going to give you several principles on what it means to be a person of prayer as we follow the model that Christ gave us in Matthew chapter 6. How do we follow the pattern that he gives us right here in his model prayer? Now, I'm finishing this series, but I want to remind you one thing that we need to know as believers in Jesus Christ. It's one thing to learn about prayer. It's one thing to think about prayer. It's one thing to hear a sermon about prayer or to do a study on prayer or to listen to a sermon on prayer or to preach a sermon on prayer. It's one thing to read a book on prayer, but it's an entirely different thing to pray. We can learn all about what it means to be people of prayer, but until we pray, it really won't make a difference. And so in this teaching and through this series, my goal and desire has been that we not only learn about prayer, but we practice what we learn, that we are participants in prayer. I told you at the beginning of the year, we're focusing on prayer, evangelism, and discipleship. Prayer, evangelism, and discipleship. And those are three fundamentals. And so we're spending some time on prayer. Soon we're talking about evangelism, and we will be emphasizing discipleship as well. So what does it mean for us to be people of prayer as we follow the model that Christ gave us in Matthew 6? Let's read Matthew 6, verse 9 through 13. Jesus says, notice this phrase, pray then like this. In other words, pray in this manner. Can we read this aloud together? It's right there on your screens. It's on your Bible in front of you. Can we read this aloud this morning together? Would you read it with me? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, most translations add this last phrase that all of you know. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Man, that was neat to be able to do that together. I can remember as a baseball player right before the baseball game, we'd all gather together and one person on the team would lead us in the Lord's Prayer. Every time before we played baseball, we'd pray the Lord's Prayer, and then they'd be cussing and chewing and fussing and fighting all throughout the game. Like, it was just one of those things that they did, right? It was just kind of a habit or kind of, that we're just going to recite this prayer. Maybe God will help us not get hurt, and maybe if we do the Lord's Prayer, we'll be able to win this baseball game. But really, what are we learning when we read, when we study Matthew chapter 6? Jesus gives us a model, a pattern to follow. I heard about two guys that were walking around one day, and one was talking about how religious he was. He was just this great religious guy. He says, man, you are not religious. He said, oh, I'm so religious. He says, you couldn't even recite the Lord's Prayer. I'll give you $10 if you can recite the Lord's Prayer. The guy looked back at him and said, you're going to be sorry. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul would take. The guy looked at him and said, man, I didn't think you could do it. And he reached in his pocket and gave him $10. Now think about it like this. The Lord's Prayer, it's a pattern for us to follow. Think for a moment. Let's just think about this. How much time do we spend watching television? How much time do we spend getting ready in the mornings, looking in the mirror? How much time do we spend talking on the phone or How much time do we spend texting in church? I'm looking this way. That's our student section. I probably need to look this way too, adults. How much time do we spend on social media? You know what one pastor said? One pastor said, one thing that social media will do one day is it will, as we stand before God and we say, well, God, I just didn't have enough time. He's going to look back at how much time we spent on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and Snapchat and YouTube and various other social media and internet platforms. And he's going to say, you know, look like you had plenty of time to me. The reality is, when we begin to think about how much we really pray, it's a little painful. It's hard to think about how much we spend doing so many other things and how much little time we spend praying. But Jesus teaches his disciples to pray. And in fact, the disciples come to Jesus and they notice that the power in his ministry, this is important. What do they say? They don't want to know how to heal. They don't want to know how to teach. They don't want to know how to work miracles, how to break that bread in a special way that it can provide for so many. What do they say? Lord, teach us to pray. What they wanted to know was the power in the life of Christ. It came through his prayer life, and they wanted to learn to pray. And so Jesus begins to teach them right here in Matthew chapter 6. We're going to look at a few things. First of all, prayer ought to honor the Lord. It ought to honor the Lord. First and foremost, our prayers ought to be about the Lord and not us. Now, in the first few verses, in verses 5 through 8, Jesus is teaching us how not to pray. He says, don't pray like the hypocrites who have these big words and they're so elaborate and loud and they put on a show. Don't pray like those people. Don't act like those religious people who want everyone else to see them pray. They're talking to man. They're not talking to God. And then he says, that's verses 5 through 8. And then he says in verses 9 through 13, pray then like this. Pray in this manner. And how does Jesus begin? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Now, one commentator said, the purpose of this prayer is to glorify God's name and to ask for help to accomplish his will on earth. This prayer begins with God's interests, not ours. God's name, God's kingdom, God's will. Prayer is a mighty instrument, not for getting man's will done in heaven, but for getting God's will done on earth. How do we begin prayer? We begin by honoring and worshiping the Lord. Prayer begins with God's plans, not man's desires. You see, in prayer, it brings man to God's plans, not God to man's plans. It's all about getting on the same page with God. That's what prayer is about. Do you notice in Matthew 6, in this model prayer, there are no singular pronouns? Nowhere. It's collective. It's plural. Everything is plural. Our Father. There's a connection. So Jesus is teaching us that prayer ought not just to be about me, myself, and I. Prayer ought to be about God, and it ought to be about the collective work that God is doing among his people. Now, I'm not saying that we never have personal requests, but I'm saying that it ought not to be the center of everything that we do when we pray. The first thing that we do in prayer should be to praise the Lord. He says, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Now, that's not a word we use a whole lot in everyday language. What you been doing? I've just been hallowing the name of the Lord, right? We don't use that word a whole lot. It's not a phrase that we use much. We know the word because it's in the Lord's Prayer and we know the Lord's Prayer. But what does it mean? It means let your name be made holy. We want to respect. We want to reverence. We want to honor the name of the Lord. God's name is not just another word. It represents his person. It represents his nature. It represents everything about who he is. To hallow the name of the Lord means to honor his name, to treat his name holy. Let me see if I can tell you a story that might give you an idea of what it means to honor the name of the Lord. Heard about a young man who first went to college. And as he's in college, he ran across the wrong crowd one day. And they were wanting him to go out and get drunk, and they were wanting him to do drugs, and they were saying, look, it's no big deal. You don't understand. Nobody's going to find out. Look, just a little bit of dope, just a little bit of alcohol. It's no big deal. You're at college. You need to cut loose. You need to have fun. He said, no, you don't understand. He said, my mom worked two jobs when I was growing up. She worked full time, and she cleaned houses on the side, and she washed dishes at a restaurant, so that she could provide a way for me, the first one in my family ever, to go to college. And he looked back at them and said, how do you think my mom would feel if she found out I'm wasting that opportunity with drugs and alcohol? I could not dishonor my mom or the family name in that way. In other words, what is he doing? He's protecting, he's hallowing, he's honoring his mother and her sacrifice by not walking down the wrong road. And when we say, God, we want your name to be uplifted, we want your name to be made holy, we're saying, I'm going to live my life in such a way that brings honor and glory to you. How dare we live in such a way to bring shame to the name of God when he has sacrificed so much for us to be here? He says we ought to honor the Lord. Let your name be made holy. Even when we pray in Jesus' name. The song that we heard the choir sing earlier, there's power in the name of Jesus. That's why it's such an awful sin to take the name of the Lord in vain. There's power in his name. We ought to honor the Lord. Secondly, we ought to obey the Lord. It's one thing to say, God, I'm going to honor you, but it's another thing entirely to begin to live your life in such a way that brings him honor through your actions. What does he say here in verse 10? If we're going to honor the Lord, we're going to obey the Lord. Look what he says. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now think about this. If I'm going to pray to the Lord, God, I want your will done on earth as it is in heaven, then I must also be willing to pray, God, I want your will done in my life as it is in heaven. You see, how can I say to the Lord, I want everybody on earth to obey your will but me? Let me do my own thing. Let me live my own way. Now, we might not say that with our lips, but very often that's how we live our lives. But if we're going to pray, Lord, may your will be done and your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven, we're saying, God, I want to obey your will. I want to do what you say. I want to follow your commandments. He says, your kingdom comes. What does that mean? That means that that he desires God to reign everywhere. That means in my life, in my marriage, in my family, in my church, in my community, at my school, at my work, at my job, everywhere, the kingdom of God should rule and reign. Until one day, the Bible says, the whole earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord. When it says your will be done, what is he teaching? It's clear that he's teaching that God's will is more important than my wants. Hello, I'm going to say that again. That God's will is more important than my wants or wishes. Your kingdom come, your will be done. You know, prayer, when it's done properly, has a way of getting us onto God's agenda, of moving us onto his path instead of trying to get God to endorse my thoughts or my plans. It's showing up and saying, God, I want to be on your agenda. I want to follow your plan and your path. And he says, God, would your will be done on earth as it is in heaven? This means that in heaven, everyone, everywhere, at all times obeys the will of the Father. Did you know that? There's no disobedience, there's no disrespect, there's no sin, there's no rebellion. In heaven, everyone, everywhere does the will of God. Could you imagine what earth would be like if that were the case? If everyone obeyed and followed the will and the plan and the purpose of God, there'd be no school shootings. There'd be no broken relationships. There'd be no need for prisons or halfway houses. Listen, if everyone on earth obeyed the will of God, like his will is accomplished in heaven, what an amazing, incredible, remarkable thing that would be. You see, prayer is surrendering my life to the purpose of God. When you pray, you are not listing all the things that you want God to help you with, you're saying, God, I want to come line my life up with your will and your purpose. And when we pray, we ought to honor the Lord. We ought to obey the Lord. And so prayer is surrendering my life to God. See, sometimes we think prayer is coming to like that great Santa Claus in the sky. And he's going to, he's been watching to see if we're naughty or nice. And based on whether or not we've been naughty or nice, we might get the stuff we ask for. And so a lot of times we treat prayer that way. God, I'm coming to you. I've tried to do my best. I've tried to be good. And so here's the deal. I need this to happen. Can you make that happen? And we think as long as we've fulfilled our end of the deal, we've been pretty nice and not naughty, that God's going to give us what... That's not at all what prayer is like. Other people treat prayer like a divine slot machine. I'm just going to pull the arm, and if I get lucky, I'm going to get what I want. And we just keep pulling the arm. If I get lucky, I'm going to get what I want. If I get lucky, I'm going to get what I want. Other people treat prayer like a buffet. So I can come and say, well, God, I know that you've said a lot in your word, and I like this part, but I don't like that part. I like this part, and I don't like that. Asparagus. That's disgusting. I don't want that. But there's bacon. I like that, right? And so we get to pick and choose what we want or what we don't want when it comes to prayer. But it doesn't work like that. He's not some divine slot machine or Santa Claus in the sky. And prayer's not like this buffet line. When we pray, we are reporting for duty, saying, God, your will be done, not mine. Isn't that what Jesus prayed right before his death? God, your will be done, not mine. I heard about a young man who'd been praying, God, show me your will. He prayed specifically, I want to share the gospel with someone. Lord, give me a sign. He prayed it that morning. He's riding the bus, the big city. He's riding the bus to work. Remember, he said, Lord, I want to share the gospel with someone. Give me a sign. That there was only one seat on the bus that was available, and it was right next to him. When this big, burly, scary-looking dude sat down right next to him. He scoots over closer to the edge because this guy's taking up about a seat and a half, and he's looking over, and he's like, all right, Lord, I know I prayed. I know I prayed that I'm supposed to share the gospel with somebody today, but God, I'm waiting on a sign. All of a sudden, this big, burly, scary-looking dude just began to cry. He said, oh man, I'm such a sinner. I know that I'm lost. I need Jesus. Is there anybody that can tell me how in the world can I know Jesus? All of a sudden, that guy right next to him looked up at the Lord and said, Lord, is this the sign? Isn't it true that very often we treat the will of God that way? God opened the door and the door's wide open, oh Lord. I told you that I walked through, but man, I kind of like a lightning bolt or maybe an audible voice. Or you gave Moses the burning bush. You gave Daniel the handwriting on the wall. You could just send me a text. That'd be fine. Just tell me what you want me to do. But in reality, as we obey the will of God, as we walk with God, as we spend more time in prayer, guess what happens? We begin to grow in that relationship. We understand his will so much better. When you know the Lord, when you walk with him faithfully, you come to understand his will. Jesus prays, your will be done. You know what that means? God, help me to obey you, to follow you. And then number three, depend on the Lord. Depend on the Lord. Here in verses 11 and 12, Jesus begins to pray. Now notice this pattern. This is the model prayer, right? Notice this pattern. How does Jesus begin his prayer? He begins by worshiping and honoring the Lord. Hallowed be your name, your will be done, your kingdom come. And then, only after that, does he move to requests that he's making personally for himself or for others. Give us this day our daily bread. Lead us not into temptation. Forgive us our debts as we forgive those who we've wronged. It's very interesting. There are three types of requests here. And as you examine this prayer, you come to realize how absolutely remarkable it is. Jesus here says, give us this day our daily bread. There's a physical need, right? There's a physical request. What's he asking for? Give us our daily bread. In other words, every one of us need food
in order to live, in order to survive. This is a physical request. Jesus is saying that all of us need certain things in life to survive. And Jesus says later in the Sermon on the Mount, listen, don't stress, don't worry about all of these other things. Your Heavenly Father knows what you need, and He can take care of you. And so here Jesus prays, give us this day our daily bread. Now remember when Israel gathered manna in the wilderness? What did they do? They gathered manna every single day, except the day before the Sabbath, they gathered an extra amount. If they gathered too much, it would go bad. If they didn't gather enough, they would go hungry. And so what did they do? Every day, they went back every day. This is a picture for us of our Christian life. How every day we need to spend time with the Lord. Every day we need to spend time in prayer. Every day we need to open the Word. Every day we need to grow closer to the Lord Jesus. It's a powerful picture of our spiritual need. Guess what? Yesterday's bread does not suffice for today, spiritually speaking. So notice what he says. Give us this day our daily bread. One commentator says, we ask for bread. This teaches us modesty because it is simply bread. We ask only for bread, not for what we do not need. The greatest of men must be indebted to the mercy of God for their daily bread. By the way, if you've got food in your pantry, if you've got a roof over you, if you've got transportation, if you've got clothes on your back, you know the reason you have it is because the goodness of God. He's the one who's provided it for you. We depend on Him, a physical request, and then a spiritual request. What does He say? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. The forgiveness that Jesus speaks of here is that practical forgiveness that we need every day to grow in Christ. Now, you've been forgiven at the cross. You've been saved. You've been adopted into the family of God. You're now, this is not talking about that forgiveness that you receive at the point of salvation. He's talking about the forgiveness that we need every day because we still mess up and stumble and fall. Hello, anybody else? Absolutely. And so what is he saying? Forgive us our debts every day as we grow closer to you, as we follow you. Forgive us for failing to do your will, for failing to honor you. It's a spiritual request. In other words, God, I want to be right with you. Forgive us our debts. You know, sin is mentioned in the Bible. The Bible talks about the wages of sin, what we owe as a result of our rebellion against God, our debts that we incur as a result of our sin. You can imagine sin like on a an accounting sheet, and you've got debits and you've got credits, and man, we have racked up the debts that we owe, and only the grace of God can forgive us and make us right. That's why I love the song that says, oh, to grace, how great a debtor. Daily I'm constrained to be. In other words, we are debtors of grace because God has forgiven our debts through the blood of Jesus Christ. He says, forgive us our debts. And then there's a relational request, as we have forgiven our debtors. I think it's interesting. We're telling the Lord, God, I want to be right with you. Forgive me of my sin, my shortcomings, and my failures. But notice this phrase, as we forgive our debtors. In other words, there's an assumption that we're right with other people and we're forgiving others. Did you notice that? He's not saying, God, forgive me, but I don't want to forgive other people. We like to do that from time to time. What's he saying? As we've already forgiven those around us, would you forgive us? Because you see, understand, a right relationship with God, knowing that we're forgiven, leads to a desire to reconcile relationships with one another in the body of Christ. How can we walk with the Lord consistently and faithfully when we fail to reconcile issues or problems with other brothers and sisters in Christ? This is exactly what the Bible's telling us. It's a relational request. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Don't think here that Jesus is saying, in order to earn forgiveness, you've got to forgive other people. That's not what he's saying. It's almost the opposite. It is that since you've been forgiven, you naturally want to forgive others. Think about that. Listen to this. This is powerful. Once our eyes have been opened to see the enormity of our offense against God, the injuries which others have done to us appear by comparison extremely trifling, small, If, on the other hand, we have an exaggerated view of the offenses of others, it proves that we have minimized our own offenses toward God. You understand what he's saying? If we fail to forgive other people, it's because we don't understand all that we've been forgiven in Jesus Christ. And if we try to play the game, God, you don't know what they did, and you don't know what he said, and you don't know how they acted, and I did this, and I did that, then it comes across like we don't really understand all that we've been forgiven of in Jesus Christ. And God looks at us and says, if I can forgive you of your sin, don't you dare hold somebody else's offense against them. There's a relational request. And here, this is interesting now. This is the first moment that Jesus comes to make a request. He begins with praise, honor the Lord, worship the Lord, obey the Lord. But let me ask you a question. In any earthly relationship you have, whether it's a husband, a wife, son, daughter, grandson, granddaughter, friend, do you enjoy a earthly relationship where the person only always asks for stuff from you? Where the only time you hear from them is, hey, this is your college student. I need more money. Books cost $3,000, which is true these days. If the only time you hear from your teenager is, can I have 20 bucks? Or the only time you hear from your friend is, you see the numbers show up on your phone and you're like, what do they need now? You know somebody like that. And so we get frustrated with our earthly relationships if the only time we hear from them is when they want or need something. But don't we do that to God? Oh, man, I got to pray. Why do you need to pray? I'm telling you what. I got to pray. I got this big test coming up. I haven't studied a bit, but I'm praying for like a resurrection power virgin birth miracle. I got to pray because, man, I'm telling you what, we got this big bill coming due. And I don't know how we're going to, I got to pray because I got to go to the doctor. I don't know what's going on. And the reality is, I wonder how it makes God feel if all we ever do is come to him when we need something. That's not a relationship. That's not a father and a son or a father and a daughter. That's not the way it's supposed to be. We begin with adoration. You know, there's that acronym, ACTS, ACTS, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. That's a great way to remember how to pray. When you're praying, just begin with adoration. Praise the Lord, honor the Lord. Then begin with confession. Confess your sin. By the way, confess your sin one by one. You commit them one by one, confess them one by one. Then thanksgiving and praise to the Lord, specific things. And then supplication. Supplication means requests on your part and requests for others as well. A-C-T-S. Real simple, real practical. Then we can request things of the Lord. Fourth, we should trust the Lord. Honor the Lord, obey the Lord, depend on the Lord, and trust the Lord. Trust him. What does he say? Verse 13, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. That's an interesting phrase. Have you ever thought about that? Why does Jesus say, don't lead us into temptation? The Bible's clear that God does not tempt us to do evil. James tells us that we're not tempted to do evil. Let no man think when he is tempted, I'm tempted by God. For God himself cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one, but each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own lust, his own desires, and enticed. And so we're tempted by the enemy to do wrong, and we're tempted by our own desires, but God is not the one that leads us to temptation. So why does he say, don't lead us into temptation? Really, a good translation of this is, don't leave us in temptation. Oh, now that's a different concept, right? Do you hear that? Not necessarily the way we would think of being led into something, but when we are tempted, don't leave us. Provide a way of escape. Provide an advocate. Provide a way for us to do the right thing. Come alongside, Holy Spirit, and enable us to live and to obey and to overcome the temptation. Don't leave us there. Don't allow us to be led into temptation. Keep us out of that temptation. He says, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us from the evil one. Why? We've got to trust the Lord because there's evil all around us. We're in the midst of evil. Jesus knew. He said, when he sent his disciples out, he said, I knew that I'm sending them as lambs as sheep to the slaughter. Because we're walking out in a world that's hostile to the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we desperately need to trust the Lord in every circumstance and in every situation. Tony Evans tells this story. Tony Evans is one of my favorite preachers. His stories are some of the best. He said, when I was a little boy growing up, I used to love to watch the telephone man. You know, the guys that would climb the telephone poles. Tony Evans said he used to love to watch them. He was fascinated. They almost looked like superheroes to him because they'd climb that pole and they'd work and they wouldn't have a rope or a net or anything around and they'd just climb the pole. And so one day he worked up the courage to go talk to the telephone pole man. The telephone pole man said, watch this. He's got special spikes in his shoes and the spikes help keep his feet where they're supposed to be when he's climbing the pole. And then the telephone man showed him something really interesting. He showed him the belt that he used. And that belt was very important. That belt would wrap around the pole, but then it would wrap around the man. The man described this to Tony. He said, listen carefully, you've got to rest. You've got to be able to put your entire weight into this belt. Tony said, man, that's probably scary. He says, real scary. In fact, the very first time that I did this, I did not trust my belt. And so I crawled all the way down the pole with my arms wrapped around the pole because I didn't trust my belt. He said, when I got down, I had splinters everywhere, all over me. And Tony Evans began to say, here's something interesting. For a telephone lineman, for somebody working that job, you've got to trust your equipment. You've got to lean into it. The best way that you're going to be held up is to lean back when it doesn't feel like you should be leaning back. It doesn't feel comfortable at first. You got your spikes in, and you got to put all your weight in the belt. Evans says this, that most of us encounter problems and issues and get a whole lot of splinters in life because we're not willing just to lean and trust God. We want to do it on our own. We want to grab around the problem. We get all scratched up and splintered up and have so many issues. When all the while God is saying, if you'll lean back, if you'll trust me, I can hold you. God says, guess what? Anyone that's leaned in and trusted me, I haven't dropped one yet. And I won't let you go. I won't let you go. It's important for us to trust the Lord as we pray. Lord, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. And then the phrase at the end, for yours is the kingdom, the power, the glory of forever and ever. I love the fact that it begins with praise and it ends with praise. Honor the Lord. Give him the praise that he deserves. Trust him. Depend on him. Listen carefully. Faithful prayer leads to spiritual growth that recognizes, that rests in the divine protection of Almighty God. Hear this, and we're done. Prayer is not about man's wants, but God's will. It's not about man's plans, but God's power. It is not about man's greatness, but it is about God's glory. That's what it means to pray like Jesus. I'm going to ask you if you'd bow your head.